Welcome to Bringing Life to Scholarship, a symposium series sponsored by the Herbert H. and Grace A. Dow College of Health Professions. I'm Dr. Peter Lubert, and will be serving as your moderator for today's presentation. If you're watching this presentation live on the web, you can email questions at any time during the presentation by clicking the Ask button. This and all previous presentations are archived and available online at www.chp.cmich.edu. Today's presentation will be given by Dr. Dawn Nelson. Dr. Nelson received her MA degree in clinical audiology in 1985 from the University of Maryland, College Park. She taught in the audiology program at Howard University and operated the Metropolitan Hearing Center in Washington, D.C. until 1990. In 1994, Dr. Nelson completed her PhD in audiology from Vanderbilt University. From 1994 to 1996, she worked as a postdoctoral fellow in the Department of Otolaryngology and in the Center for Hearing Sciences at Johns Hopkins University. Dr. Nelson joined the faculty in the Doctor of Audiology program at CMU in 1996. She helped develop the auditory electrophysiology and vestibular laboratories in the Carl Center for Clinical Care and Education at CMU. Dr. Nelson's research focuses on auditory electrophysiology, vestibular assessment, and auditory processing disorders. Today's presentation will be Test-Retest Reliability of Auditory Steady-State Responses in Normal Hearing Subjects. Dr. Nelson?
I'm going to just give you a little bit of background on what I'm going to talk about before I begin, and I would be remiss if, well, I'll tell you how it started. I have a project going from a REAP grant that was looking at some issues in auditory electrophysiology, and I had a graduate assistant working for me, and she was running data. And while she was running the data, a new test came about, the ASSR, which we'll talk about, the Auditory Steady-State Response, and she noticed some inconsistencies in the data that we were collecting. And we, after looking at it for a while, she actually changed her doctoral project and rewrote a prospectus to reflect these changes. She thought that was a more interesting question than my lofty question that I was asking. And so that is Trisha Ostermeyer. I really should call her Dr. Trisha Ostermeyer. That became the topic of her doctoral project, and she graduated, I think, a year or two ago. And so this is something that we have been working on, and I have to give her credit for noticing these inconsistencies in the data. So I have to give you a little bit of background on what audiologists do. What do we do in order for you to understand where we're going to go with this particular study? What I'm going to first talk to you about is what the basic hearing test does and what we do as audiologists when we have a subject in the room. When we bring a patient into the room, well, let me just orient you to what we call an audiogram. All right? What you're looking at, beyond all the lines and things, are frequencies or pitches across the top. So we have our very low pitches down at the bottom, all the way to our very high pitches up at the top, at the other end. So low pitches to high pitches, and these represent the frequencies that we typically hear in normal everyday speech and conversation. On the y-axis, we have levels of loudness. So we have very soft sounds to very loud sounds. Oops, very soft sounds to very loud sounds. Let me get rid of this. And what we do is find the level at which a patient can respond to these sounds at all of these different pitches 50% of the time. So we start loud and get softer and softer and softer until the patient raises their hand 50% of the time, and we call that their auditory threshold or their hearing threshold. And so we would consider broadly anybody that can respond to a sound that's about 20 decibels or 20 dB, we call it, or lower, is someone that has normal hearing. And just to give you an idea of what that means in terms of function, if we look at this same audiogram, now we've put some pictures on it to show you what everyday sounds occur in these particular hearing levels, water dripping is about 20 decibels, just to give you an idea. Some of the sounds that we hear, P and F and H, these are high-pitched sounds. Remember, the higher pitches are up here, the lower pitches are down here. A dog barking is about 70 dB. But look down here, we have an airplane flying. That's about 120 decibels. And we can evaluate all of these pitches and all of these levels of loudness in the hearing suites here in the clinic. So anything 20 or below, these numbers are going to become important, is considered to be normal hearing. And so people that have hearing losses may have normal hearing through the lower pitches, and then they may have high frequency hearing losses. These are typically our older patients that we fit with hearing aids. Different configurations, that would be the shape of the hearing loss. We can see all manner of configurations in the clinic. So that's just to give you an idea of what we do basically to test. Now there's another test that we use to evaluate hearing, and that is the auditory brainstem response test. Now what is the auditory brainstem response test in 1 minute? It usually takes me a whole semester to say what it is. And so it's really electrical activity generated from the brainstem in response to sound. So we put sound into the ear and we track that sound all the way. And we put sound in the ear, we put electrodes on the patient, and we look for squiggly lines, if you will, that are going to track that sound from the ear all the way to the base of the brainstem. So this is brainstem activity that's going to arise from auditory structures that are found in the central auditory nervous system. And so we would put electrodes on a patient such as this. We have other configurations that we use, but this is our typical configuration, one on the ear, one on the forehead or middle of the head, one on the high forehead. And we put a sound in the ear, and then we're going to record these responses. So when we do this, we're going to get a very predictable response that has five different waves that are repeatable and that are predictable at certain intensities. So if you put in a 90 dB signal into the ear, you're going to get a waveform in most normal hearing patients that looks like this, and they're going to occur at a certain time or certain latency, and it's going to have a certain amplitude, and we name them waves one, waves two, all the way to wave five. So that's the auditory brainstem response, or the ABR we call it. And so this is your typical auditory brainstem response that you would get. Now as you lower the intensity of the sound, this brainstem response is going to lower in amplitude, and it's going to shift in latency all the way to the point where you get a flat line. And at that point when you get a flat line, you can estimate where the person's hearing would be if you were to put them, their behavioral threshold, if you were to put them in a booth that would correspond or correlate to that behavioral threshold. So these are more objective thresholds. The one in the booth where you directly present the sound and have them raise their hand, we call those behavioral thresholds. These do not require the response of the patient. So when we're estimating thresholds, it's important, a term I want you to get familiar with is what that threshold is. What is a regular behavioral threshold? I told you 0 through 20. ABR thresholds are a little bit higher. We use a sort of correction factor, if you will, when we're doing it objectively. And so we're going to really look at how we best estimate hearing thresholds in individuals. This is just to give you an example of, I know it looks like a bunch of squiggly lines, but of what we do. So we have here along this y-axis levels of loudness. So this would be very, very soft to very, very loud. So if we present a loud stimulus, we're going to get that wave 1 through 5. And as we go down to 10, you can see that it's not as pretty, the morphology is not as good, and you can only just see wave 5. And at 0, you get basically a flat line. So we're going to estimate here their ABR threshold is 10, but we correct about 10 dB, and we would say that this person for this stimulus has normal hearing. And in fact, if we look at that audiogram, which is that same thing, here's 20, we can see that if we looked at their behavioral thresholds, they're within the normal hearing range. So that's how you would do an ABR threshold. Well, why do we use ABR to assess hearing? Why would we? Because we have patients that can't raise their hand. They can't sit in the chair and say, I hear the tone. And so we use them for infants, and we see lots of newborns in our clinic. This week I saw a 12-day-old baby. And we also can use them on other difficult-to-test patients, such as patients with developmental delays, patients in comas, very old patients who may be inconsistent. So infants and difficult-to-test patients, where it's necessary for us to evaluate their hearing, maybe to ensure the quality of their lives. Do they need hearing aids or what kind of help they may need? So we have to be able to objectively evaluate hearing when we need to. How good is the ABR at estimating hearing? Well, if we look at the difference between an ABR threshold and behavioral threshold, we can see, if we just look at adults, and these are at the different pitches, we have pretty consistent normative data that's published that tells us that at this frequency, we can correct at this level, at this frequency, we correct at that level. And there are various, charts that you can use. You really have to choose the one that you believe in and kind of stick with that. Or typically what we do is collect our own normative data for our clinic and we use that. So we could, it's a pretty good estimator, the ABR. But there are some limitations with using the auditory brainstem response. One is, in order to get complete data on a newborn infant, so you've got this new little baby, they failed the hearing screening, the mother wants to know, does my baby hear? You want to know exactly the severity and the configuration of that hearing loss. It's very time consuming, especially here at CMU. We don't sedate our babies. We do what we call a sleep hunger deprived ABR, where we say let them miss their last bottle and their last nap, and we feed them, and hopefully they'll sleep for 2 or 3 hours. In other places, they sedate, or in older babies, they sedate them. One is that there's another reason that we consider it a little limited is that there's compromise of frequency specificity. We want to know each one of those pitches, what their hearing is like, and be able to describe that. There's some problems with the stimulus that we use for the auditory brainstem response, whether it actually represents the frequency region that you want to represent, and that's a whole nother discussion. There's also a range of hearing loss that can be predicted and limited. After there is a certain amount of hearing loss in a patient, let's say beyond 70 dB, so that's a very loud level that they, where their thresholds are, you really can't record a reliable ABR. That doesn't mean that the person doesn't have residual hearing. It just means that we're not able to quantify it in those levels. So you really can't distinguish between a person that has a severe hearing loss or a person that has a profound hearing loss. Neither can you describe the configuration. So that's a problem when it comes to hearing aid fitting. Another good reason, and I think all of our students that are here can relate to this, is that it's very subjective. Peak picking, you know, you saw all the squiggly lines, and we have discussions about is this wave 5 or is this wave 5, and one person might have one idea of what it is, and another person may have another idea, and that can be serious when you're really trying to determine what the threshold is and whether or not a baby needs a hearing aid or not. You can't tell a person that their little precious one needs a hearing aid, and you know, my nightmare is that a year or two later they walk in talking and laughing with normal hearing, and I told them, the parents, when they were new, that they had a hearing loss. So these are some of the many limitations of using the auditory brainstem response. So I want to remind you what it looks like, because I'm going to show you some of the subjectivity that I'm talking about. So remember, we have this is to a loud sound. We have this repeatable, predictable waveform with 5 components. Now, this is the actual threshold search of a baby that I did a year or two ago. And what we have levels here. In the left ear, 60, 40, 50, 25, 20. So it's going from loud to soft. And so what we have here is what I consider to be wave 5, and then here is whatever here, and then, so none of this represents the absence of sound. The question is, where is the threshold for this particular pitch? And there's a lot of subjectivity. My natural inclination is to run to Dr. Rayner's office and say, what do you think? And sometimes we have different debates about where it is. But it's not as frivolous as I'm saying it to you, but you can see that there's a problem and there can be a problem identifying exactly where that threshold is. So why do we even care about this? The reason we care is because the Joint Committee on Infant Hearing, and I'm going to relate it to Michigan, and our Michigan early hearing detection intervention program says that we, for our babies to have good speech and language development, we need to identify their hearing loss by the time they're 3 months of age, and we need to intervene before they're 6 months of age, which means your baby needs to be identified. We need to say they have a hearing loss before they're 3 months old. And so that requires them to be screened in the hospital. So now we have what we call universal hearing screening, where it's mandated that all babies be screened for hearing in the hospital. And I'm going to show you some data why that has become important. So if we identify them by 3 months, by the time we go through repeat visits and medical clearance and all of those kinds of things, we can do intervention by 6 months. Does the child need, do they have an ear infection and need medication or PE tubes? Do they need a cochlear implant? Do they need a hearing aid or two hearing aids? So all of these things are important. That's why we care. The National Center for Hearing Assessment and Management says that about 12,000 babies are born each year with a permanent hearing loss or hearing loss that impacts speech and language development. That's a lot of babies that are born, and so that's why we care. In Michigan, if we were to put incidence data along with what happens in Michigan, we know that there are about 133,000 babies born each year in the state of Michigan. We know that the incidence of hearing loss is about 0.1 to 0.6% in the population at large. So if we apply that to our state, we can see that potentially 800 babies have hearing loss that is going to impact their development when they go to school or their speech and language development. And so it's important that we catch these babies early, and it's important that we intervene as soon as we can. Just, I don't want you to look at this whole thing, but I want to just show you something. These are babies that were not screened. This was a study done by Harrison et al. In 2003, and they looked at what was the age of identification of babies that were not screened. So the important thing is that of babies that had moderate to mild hearing losses, they were identified about 25 months old. That's 2 years old. Here, 30 months old, 32 months old. That's old. That's way after you're supposed to develop speech and language. And so if we compare that with babies that are screened at birth and identified early on, when did intervention take place? 10 months. And 12 months. So we're getting closer to our goal of identifying babies at 6 months of age. So that's why we care about this. And these two studies, Yoshinaga Itano has done a couple of studies as well as others to show that early intervention has an impact on language development. This just represents broadly a language quotient, and the top bar, the dark bar, says those that had were identified before 6 months have a higher language quotient than those that were identified after 6 months. And that goes in terms of, that goes across ethnicity, gender, and age. At all points, it's better for a baby when their hearing loss is identified early. So the goals, in a nutshell, of early identification are finding the cause of the hearing loss, identifying the degree and the configuration for proper fitting and proper intervention, providing the medical intervention if needed, providing habilitative intervention, that's hearing aids and things like that, or surgical intervention, those are cochlear implants and things like that. Again, just to remind you that the ABR does have some serious limitations, but that's what we're using right now, and we feel pretty good about it. That's what brings us, though, to the auditory steady-state response. So This is another response in addition to the auditory brainstem response. And there, while we were getting very happy with the ABR, and that's what we use, and we use it today, there were some investigators in Australia piddling away at their experimental benches and looking at other ways that we can evaluate newborn hearing that may be a little more reliable than the ABR. So what is the ASSR, the Auditory Steady-State Response? It's an evoked response, just like the ABR, that's recorded in response to tones that are amplitude and frequency modulated. So basically what they do are take tones and manipulate them in some way and in an effort to get a stronger evoked response. And a lot of this work was done by Rickards and Clark, and they've done lots of research since that point. So it's a brain or brain stem response. It is a neural response from auditory structures. And the stimulus that we put into the ear is a continuous tone. And the reason why that's important is because for ABR, we use very short duration tones, which have problems with identifying specific frequencies. So this uses a lot longer tone that has some components that are better, we're better able to zero in on exactly where the hearing loss is occurring. And the response is one that follows the envelope of complex tones. So there are a couple of terms that you need to be familiar with in order to understand the auditory steady state response. I'm just going to refer to it as the ASSR. One is the carrier tone. What is the carrier tone? It's the tonal test signal. It's the frequency of the signal that I'm interested in. So if I want to know how you hear at 1,000 hertz, the carrier tone would be 1,000 hertz, because we're going to be looking at lots of different types of frequency aspects, but the carrier tone is the frequency of interest, and it indicates the region of the inner ear that's being stimulated, which is what we need to know for proper fitting. And then the carrier tone is going to be manipulated in both the amplitude or intensity domain as well as the frequency domain. So we're going to take a continuous tone and we're going to do some manipulations with it. Very generally, I'll just tell you that in the amplitude mode, and we call it amplitude modulation, what we're going to do is modulate it to a certain degree several times per second. It just so happens many papers have shown that 100% modulation is the best type of modulation for these tones. So we use a modulation depth of 100%, which is essentially turning the tone on and off. And then we're going to modulate it so many times per second. And what you'll see is for each pitch, we vary the modulation rate. So for one pitch, it may be that we vary it on and off 87 times per second. And for another, we're going to vary it 93 times per second. And for another, we may vary it 77 times per second. But each of them go on and off several times per second. So this would be an example of the tone on. Here's the sinusoid. So it's full on here, then it's full off, full on, full off, and so it's modulated like that several times per second. And so the amplitude modulation rate, which is a term that is important, is how many times per second we turn that tone on and off. Frequency modulation refers to the pitch. We're not just going to present a pure tone, which we do in the test situation here in our booth for behavioral testing. What we're going to do is vary the frequency of that pitch around the carrier tone. And lots of research has come out about what's best, and we've determined that 10% frequency modulation is best. So to give you a definition, the frequency modulation be the process of continually varying the frequency of the test tone around the carrier tone. Just to give you a peek at what that might look like, if I have a 1,000 hertz tone right here, and I'm going to vary it 10% around the carrier tone, I'm going to vary it this way towards 900 hertz up to about 1,100 hertz, and it's going to sound sort of like a little warble tone. I don't sing very well. And then, and then we're also going to remember that's frequency modulation, but we're also going to be amplitude modulating it at a certain rate So frequency modulation and amplitude modulations are things that we do with these continuous tones, and we do it at an amplitude modulation rate that will become important in analyzing the ASSR. So this is just to show you, here's a tone that we have, a 1,000 hertz tone. If we were to look at the overall envelope of the tone, we can see it's full on and full off. And if we do that for different frequencies, for 500 hertz, 1,000 hertz, 2,000, 4,000, what we're eventually going to do is combine the four of those together and put them into a tone like this and present this to the patient. So this tone is going to be amplitude modulated, frequency modulated, and it's going to have four separate frequencies at the same time presented to both ears. People lay awake at night thinking of these things. So what we're going to do, we're going to present this, put the electrodes on, and we're going to measure what the brainstem is doing in response to this tone. So the resulting electrical activity is going to be measured at the amplitude modulation rate. Okay, so there's a little glitch here. I put a 1,000 hertz tone, that's the carrier tone, into the person's ear, but I may have put it in at a modulation, an amplitude modulation rate of 87 cycles per second. And so I'm going to be analyzing the response at 87 hertz. And if I see a response at 87 hertz, I will know that the person heard the tone to that 1,000 hertz. I hope that makes sense to you. And what we're really looking at is the ability of neurons to phase lock or to spike or to fire at the amplitude modulation rate of the carrier tone. So phase locking is a term, is the tendency of nerve fibers to synchronize to the amplitude modulation rate of the stimulus. So they're not going to synchronize to the frequency of the stimulus. They're synchronizing to the amplitude modulation rate of the stimulus, and we're going to look for the response there. Don't read that. It's just saying that what we're going to do then is compare at the amplitude modulation rate how strong that signal is, and we're going to compare that statistically to how strong the signal is at an amplitude modulation rate that we're not actually presenting, and statistically see whether they're the same or whether they're different or whether this has happened by chance. All right, so just to give you an example, we've put in this 1,000 hertz signal that has been amplitude modulated and frequency modulated, and you get a response that's going to occur at a certain distance, and we can actually calculate what the amplitude modulation rate is. What are some of the benefits that people think about it? One of the benefits, the big benefits, is there's no visual detection of component peaks. It's more objective. There's no peak picking in ASSR. The machine does it for you, so it takes away that subjectivity that we talked about. It's more frequency specific, so we're better able to fit amplification or better able to treat our children, the babies. There's a greater output potential. Remember I told you it's limited when we start getting severe hearing loss to profound. It sort of gets mushy with ABR, but when you use the ASSR, theoretically, you're able to give a stronger output, so you're able to specifically diagnose hearing disorders in those higher intensity ranges. And you're, as I said before, you're able to distinguish between severe to profound hearing losses, if different from complete hearing losses. It's not affected by state of arousal. For ABR, the baby has to be asleep or sedated. We said that it takes, our morning appointments for babies can last 3 hours, and they say that these are shorter test times. So that's a really good thing, if it's true. And then the other thing is we don't have to measure anything. It's already done for us. Some limitations is that research has shown, number of studies have shown, that it's better predictor of hearing loss in patients that have a hearing loss than in patients that have normal hearing. Well, initially, just right off the bat, that's a problem. Because what it's saying is people that have normal hearing can appear as though they have a hearing loss. Well, you can't tell somebody whose baby has normal hearing that their baby has a hearing loss. So that's an inherent problem for me right off the bat. but limited ASSR results in patients with neurological disorders. So now if you've got a baby that has other complications, let's say, neurological problems, we don't have a lot of data because it's so new as to how we use it in neurologically dysfunctioning patients. And the big issue is that there's a lack of test-retest reliability. You can't use a clinical test that has not been shown to have good test-retest reliability, which brings us to what we're going to do right now is we were looking at this using the ASSR. It's commercially available by about, at the time there were two companies, there are a couple more available now, and we were finding that over time we were getting different results. And so we thought, well, let's look at it. We did a review of the literature and found no one has ever looked at this, so we decided to look at it, and we had several questions. How reliable is it over time? Is it a good predictor of hearing thresholds? Because it has to be able to do that. Does it take as much time as the ABR? Does it influence the results? Does noise influence the results in a clinical situation? And does state of arousal affect the results? So what we did, we brought 35 young normal hearing, we got lots of students, so 35 young normal hearing students, and we saw them in two test sessions that were divided by 3 weeks apart. And we did behavioral testing where they raised their hand and to the beeps. We did that at every test session, along with a battery of other tests. We put the electrodes, we set them up, that their montage was in the routine montage for ABR, which happens to be the same for the ASSR. We used one of the big commercially available pieces of equipment, the Biologic Nav Pro, their master program. And we used the default settings. You can't change the default settings on the NAFRO. One of the things we learned was in reading all these studies, they had all of these different parameters, but when you buy your equipment, you can't change the parameters. So what they're showing that they can do, we can't necessarily show because you can't change from the default parameters. So we wanted to see in a regular clinical situation what's going to happen. And we evaluated we did threshold searches from 50 dB down to 0 dB. And we thought, we have all normal hearing, let's see what happens. And so it's very simple in the way it looks. It's just set up almost like a laptop, and so everything is very neat to do. We use pure tones. We did the test frequencies that are typical, four test frequencies. We did the frequency modulation as well as the amplitude modulation. Each test frequency was assigned a different amplitude modulation rate, which means we had four frequencies in this ear, four frequencies in this ear, and all eight of them had different amplitude modulation rates. And then we are able to test all eight simultaneously. So this is just showing you, the blue represents left. These are the different stimuli. If you put them together, that is the response. And as you look at, if you look at this, these are the frequencies represented here. You can see that we have energy at 500, 1,000, 2,000, and 4,000, even though that's the signal. If you do a spectrum analysis of the signal, and that's for both the left and the right ear. The analysis of the ASSR is done by computer algorithm, so it's very automatic. The algorithms are applied to the collected electrical fields that you get from the output of the electrodes. And we look for the presence or absence of the ASR by frequency, for each frequency. And an F-test is performed to see whether or not the response that we think we're getting is significantly different from the noise that's inherent in the signal. And just to give you a brief, this is sort of how it looks. And we have the left ear and the right ear, and we have the different frequencies and the same frequencies repeated here. And we have all red buttons, meaning we're not doing anything, and we're at 60 dB. And then if we're at 50 dB, you can see for the left ear, for the first three frequencies, we have a good signal, and for the fourth one, we don't. So if we look over here, this represents 500 hertz, 1,000 hertz, 2,000 hertz, and 4,000 hertz. These numbers represent the amplitude modulation rate of those frequencies. So you can see here we've got three green lights, that this yellow signal is clearly above, statistically above, the noise level. But for the fourth one at 4,000 hertz, you can see that the signal is still embedded in the noise. And so it has not reached statistical significance here. And the same thing is repeated here. This would be 500, 1,000, 2,000, and 4,000 for the right ear. And you can actually look and see which ones are there and which ones are not. But for ease, you can look at noise values and all kinds of things. Then we have it, you can see them emerging. And then when they're all green, you can see that the signal is statistically above the level of the noise. Then we can change to a lower score here, a lower intensity at 40 dB. Here we have, you can see that this one has not quite arisen above the noise. Here we have all green lights, and you can see that they're all good, and these are the so we know that if we analyze a signal at 82 hertz, which is the amplitude modulation rate assigned to 500 hertz in the left ear, we can say that person must be hearing 500 hertz, okay? Then we can actually use that and derive an audiogram, that same first thing that I showed you that says that 20 or above is within normal limits, and there's a correction factor that you can apply, and it actually will generate an audiogram for you. What results did we find? We looked, first of all, at the test-retest reliability, which was our first basic question. So we wanted to see if during session one, the ASSR thresholds were the same as during session two. So session one versus session two. So what we're looking at here are all left ear scores, 5, 1, 2, and 4, and then all right ear scores, 5, 1, 2, and 4. And what we did was apply what we call an interclass correlation coefficient, which is a statistical process that you use to look at test-retest reliability. And the literature says that 0.7, an R value of 0.7 or above, is considered to be good correlation between session one and session two. So here are all of our interclass correlation coefficients. And you can see that none of them are above 0.7. We range from 0.191 to 0.654. So I would say that our test-retest reliability was poor to moderate, is what we'd say. None of it was considered to be good. We can look at the thresholds of session one versus the thresholds of session two. So we can see that there may be some differences between what the person's threshold was using ASSR between session one and session two. And then we can also compare left ear to right ear. So we did all of those ANOVAs, and we found that overall, the right ear had lower scores, that there was poor correlation between the sessions. But interestingly, we found that in this last column, there are a number of no responses. And we considered a no response to be no response at 50 dB or greater. Remember, all of the subjects have normal hearing. So you should be getting a response at least 50 dB. So at 500 hertz in the left ear, we had 9 of our 35 subjects that showed no response at some frequency, which is, in this study, it doesn't look like a lot, but when it's your 12-day-old baby, that's significant. That's me telling you that your baby has a hearing loss. Here we have 12, 3, 8, 5. So we have a number of non-responses, no responses, which we found to be highly unsatisfactory. And everything that we did, these no responses really kind of took over. If we look at this scatter plot, we said, well, the ANOVAs look at the overall effect of ear and frequency and all those wonderful things. Let's look at what each individual person did. So over on the x-axis, we have session one for ASSR, and then we have session two. So if we just look at 500 hertz in the left ear, so we have left ear and right ear, and we have different frequencies, 5, 1, 2, and 4. So if we just look at the left ear at 500 hertz, and this would be session one and session two. If the person's threshold, ASSR threshold, was the same for session one as it was for session two, then all of the dots would line up along the diagonal line. Well, you can see that's clearly not the case. And also, look at the no responses. We have no responses. So if you're in this column or the top column, that represents a no response. If your threshold was greater for session two, your responses occurred above the diagonal line. And if your thresholds were less for session two, they were below the line. So what you see here, just as an overall picture, is that there are very few that are lining up along the dotted line. And so there's a lot of variability here. There's a difference between ears. There's lots of no response. We have about 49 non-responses, and that worried us a little bit. We looked then at the differences. So this difference between ASSR thresholds or session one and session two. So what we did was subtract one from the other to look at just the absolute value of what those differences are. So the difference in the left ear between session one and session two of 500 hertz, there was an 8 dB difference, a 10 dB difference, a 12 dB difference. Usually in an audiometric situation, we consider a 5 dB difference to be variability and tester and subject, and so we were able to look at that, but also look at all the non-responders there also. All right, so the differences now, so we answered the question about whether or not it has good test-retest reliability, and I think we're saying no. I think we need to go back to the drawing board a little bit and improve on that. Then we looked at whether or not it was a good estimator of hearing thresholds. So let's look at the difference between the ASR thresholds and behavioral thresholds. Because we had normal adults, we could test them in the test situation as well as do their ASSR thresholds. And what we see, we're going to look at the differences during session one and session two. The difference between their behavioral threshold and the ASSR threshold for 500 hertz, for example, is 26.9 dB. That's a lot. The reason why, if this were constant with everyone, we could use a correction factor. The problem is we compared it to the literature and found that these numbers are very different and that they have huge variabilities if you look at the standard deviations. And so that's just to give you a look there. Then we looked at the average difference in thresholds. Oh, so this is the a comparison of just a few of those papers that we looked at. Here's our current study, and you can see an example would be there's a difference at 500 hertz in our study of 29 dB, but in this study it's only 14, and in this one it's 7. And so that's a problem. That's a problem. All right, we looked at test administration time, and we know that the ABR can take 2 to 3 hours unsedated. It's a lot faster if the baby's sedated. And for our sessions, they were averaging about 40 to 45 minutes. The literature states that they can take as short as 30 minutes. Some people report up to 2 hours. And so we were just able to collect some data on how long it was taking us to get some data, keeping in mind that some of our patients never even got a threshold because we had some non-responders. Noise levels, you wanted to see whether physiological noise had an effect on the responses. And this is important because babies don't always just lay there still. And so we wanted to make sure, especially if they have other disorders going on and other neurological noise going on, we wanted to see how that impacted our results. Biologic said to us that we needed to have less than 20 microvolts of noise in our recordings. And so we measured our overall recordings, the noise levels, and compared it to what we should have. And you can see that all of our noise levels were less than the recommended. We had less noise in the right ear than the left ear, and we had less noise at higher frequencies than lower frequencies. And that might have something to do with the fact that we found lower thresholds in the right ear. Could be because there was less noise in the recording. So we don't know whether that's an issue. Well, I for a fact know that there's some low-level noise in our left earphone that comes from the company. We've had it sent back several times, and they say that's just part of what is going on. But we know for a fact that noise did not impact, and we ran statistics on this to see how ANOVAs, to see whether or not there was a significant difference, and there was not a significant impact of noise, and all of ours came within the recommended levels. We looked at state of arousal. because they're saying that the baby can be mildly awake. We had adults, and we gave them a number one if they were soundly sleeping, a number two if they were sleeping for half the session, a number three if they were just laying there with their eyes closed. We called it quiet wakefulness, and a four if they were just plain awake. And we found that most of our subjects were either sleeping or sleeping during at least half the sessions, and about 10 of them, or during 10 sessions, they were quiet wakefulness. All of them had their, in all conditions, the eyes were closed. And so we found that you can get reliable recordings, but our best recordings and our lowest thresholds occurred when they received the number one, when they were asleep. So to say that babies don't have to sleep, I think, is not really accurate, at least based on what we found. So there's a lot of other little details that we found that you're probably not interested in. But just to conclude, the questions that we asked and what we found, we asked the basic question, does the ASSR have good test-retest reliability? Is it a good predictor of thresholds, and does it compare with the ABR? And what we found is that there's weak to fair test-retest reliability. And so can we use it clinically? I don't think so. Because what that means is that one day the baby can look hearing impaired, and the next day they may not look hearing impaired, or that we can offset or we can overestimate the degree of hearing loss, which I think has a lot of inherent problems. One place that we need to look further is a test-retest reliability in babies that have severe to profound hearing loss, where it's found to be more helpful. That might show some differences. And we found another big finding is that many of our subjects had no recordable ASSR thresholds, which is another big problem. Because if you see no recordable ASR threshold in a baby, you consider that to be a serious hearing loss, a profound hearing loss for that frequency. And so we think that this really justifies the fact that we need to be very guarded in at least this version or these early versions of the ASSR. So it's going in the right direction. It's available. I'm grateful that we have it here at CMU. I think that we do educate all of our students in this area, because I think as time goes on, they will improve the software so that we can use it better. But I do think that these are things that we need to take into consideration.
Dr. Nelson, thank you. That was very interesting. This and I would like to open the paper for questions, as you have suggested. Okay. I'll start us off with a question, and you somewhat started to answer my question, actually, with your conclusion slide. And I hope my question isn't naive, but it seems like these evoked potentials are all pre-conscious tests, that is, before the person is necessarily aware of the sound within the central nervous system. Mm-hmm. And so my question was, how closely do they correlate, that is, the evoked potentials, with the person's actual awareness that's going to be in parts of the nervous system beyond the brainstem towards cortical level?
Well, you know, it's an interesting question. The answer is, I don't know for this particular wave, because it does occur pre-consciousness. The earliest ABR waves occur at 1.5 milliseconds after the stimulus has been presented, after stimulus onset. So, and wave five occurs at 5.5 milliseconds. A millisecond is 1/1000th of a second after the stimulus. So that's, we don't know, but there are other evoked potentials, namely the P300 and the mismatch negativity, that can be recorded from the cortex, and they require conscious awareness of the stimulus. And you can present that stimuli, and they have their own set of parameters, at high levels down to low levels. And you can get pretty good threshold levels using some of these other measures. The problem is that because they're cortical, they're highly subjective to state of arousal. And so that's fine in an adult. That's not fine in a 12-day-old baby.
Sure. Yes.
I'm curious if you know how other people are using ASSR, and are they combining it with ABR because it's sensitive to the more severe hearing losses?
You know, That's an interesting question. The answer is I only know anecdotally, and in many of the papers that I read, they may compare thresholds of both, but how people are using them clinically, I'm not absolutely sure. But I think one of the better ways to use it would be if you do an ABR until we know more and you get no response, so you don't know whether or not the hearing loss is 70 dB or 100 dB or absolutely no response, then I might be inclined to do an ASSR to see whether or not it can tease out some of those fine differences in the severe hearing loss category. But that might be an interesting question to find out. Biologic might have some of that information, but it's not published yet.
Are there any other questions? Thank you, everyone, and thank you, Dr. Nelson.